2017 Bristol Community City Council meeting. We first have a moment's silence. Like everyone was saying, we pledge allegiance.
We pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, we'll get started. First thing I wanted to do is thank everybody for coming tonight and thank the city council for supporting me as the mayor. I'm not sure that I deserve this seat, but I'm giving my best shot, and I take every challenge seriously, so we'll hopefully work together. There'll be some tough times, there'll be some tough discussions, but we'll work through it, we'll work through it professionally. The first thing I want to do is tell you that we try to hit the ground running. I'm meeting with the city manager every Friday to go over the things we need to work on. This Friday, the vice mayor will be with us. So we've put together a detailed objective list for fiscal year 2018, and we'll have copies for you. Just like to hit the highlights and just kind of tell you what's on the objective list, because I'm the kind of person, I don't like surprises. I want to kind of tell you what we're intending to do this year, what we're going to try to look at. Some of these items will require city council approval and votes. Some of it will not. But as you listen through the last several months to a year of city council meetings, I think a lot of this you'll recognize. We talked about some of this in different forums. So the first item I had on the list was financial policies. I feel like one of the important things for the city is to establish a really strong set of financial policies. Included in that is to establish a maximum debt limit threshold, to establish minimum reserve fund levels, to establish a financial disclosure and return on investment fund request for all outside agencies and individuals asking for money from the city. To have a quarterly financial flash from the CFO to tell us how we're doing on revenues and costs. Looking at the top 10 highest trended costs, so we've got a picture of how the costs are moving as far as the city budget items. Look at asset review policies. How are we approving assets? Do we have specifications centered around assets? Are we buying just the needed asset necessary to do the job? And then the last one under financial policies is to do a financial policy performance requirement for revenue generating city entities. Like we have the golf course and we have the waste dump that are revenue generating entities. And so we want to put together a financial performance requirement for those of what they're going to do to either break even or make money for the city so they don't subsidize those. Number two is a big item, which is forensic legal and financial audits and reviews, which date back to about 2010. I want to make sure we understand the context of what we're trying to do here. We want to go back and look at what got us to this point. We want to look at what led up to today. We want to try to find what policies or programs or procedures we need to put in place so that the city's in a better position going forward, that we don't have these things that have happened in the past to get us to where we are today. So these legal and financial audits are to look at basically where the money flowed, basically follow the money. Where did the transaction of funds go with all the projects, which include the falls, all the development projects, which there's a number of them that were done through BDU development funds. There's a number of them that were done with tax relief projects. We want to look at those and see if there are any things we need to learn out of that. And then we want to look at the development contracts to see if all the contracts that were put in place for all these developments were done properly, if the city's exposed in any way, or if we need to do something different on how we put contracts together. Do we have all the right clauses? Do we have all the right approvals in place? Do we have all the right legal reviews in place? The next one is funds disbursements. How are funds dispersed when we have a development project, whether it be through BDU or a capital project? Do we have the right approvals? Are those funds reviewed properly before the approval is made? And then the last thing is to look at the city charter review to make sure that things in the city charter that are out of date need to be updated to put our policies better in position. We do that. So there will be a number of things we identify in the charter, so we're not trying to create a laundry list of things. We're going to look at the big items and take care of things that are important. The next one is really big, is the economic growth program. So we're going to basically relook at how we do economic growth. Everybody knows that every municipality and community has an industrial development authority or an economic development authority, right? And that's established by state law. So they're there to do certain things like transfer assets of real estate and so forth. But we want to do economic development in a much different way. We want true economic development. We want to balance this marketplace in the city. We want to bring industrial jobs in. We want to bring high-paying professional jobs, engineering-type jobs. So in order to do that, we're going to have to look at a whole different program. So this economic growth program will do a few things. One, it would establish a business advisory council. This will be made up of business executives. So these are senior-level business executives that have been in the marketplace for a number of years or a career, and they would look at this region and what we're trying to accomplish and help guide us on where we should go economically, types of businesses we should focus on, the types of industries we should focus on. The next would be create a regional economic city, county board of directors. So create a board of directors that decides of those advisory council recommendations, what do we act on and where do we go with these. The next one will be execute a regional economic development agreement. So if the city of Bristol partners with surrounding counties or even the city on the other side of the line, that we have agreements to put in place that establishes how we're going to together do economic development. So we pool our resources, we pool our money, we leverage the engine of economic development. You can't do it as a standalone city, but you can really be powerful if you're a whole region. So we will get some agreements in place to do that. We want to retain a global professional firm. The way this is done right is you have a professional firm that does this as a business. They know how to reach out to touch all global businesses at the executive level. They can present the city or the region, right, in a professional manner and say, here's what I'm marketing to you. Here's the region. Here's its economic levers. Here's what it's got to offer. Here are the types of businesses we're after. So this firm would be paid and established to help us do economic development every day, all day. And the next one is to set a city zoning review, so you have to be prepared for development. I think we get a look at how the city is zoned, where we want industrial companies, where we want businesses, where we want neighborhoods, and make sure that's all in line. And the next few items are very quick. One, number four is to do a revenue and tax collection projection, which is a quarterly report by the CFO Commissioner, Revenue and Tax Commissioner, to give us revenue and tax collection projections quarterly. So we know where we are, so if there are any big problems, we can identify those early. We don't wait until we're a month away from the budget approval to find out we've got a problem. The next one is to take the 2018 comprehensive plan, which was put together by the Planning Commission, and to establish what action items that plan needs to accomplish this year with a semi-annual report on status. So come to us at mid-year and at the end of the fiscal year and tell us how you're doing against those objectives. The next two are city department actions. One is to put together a three-year comprehensive plan. So if the city were to grow by 10%, what would be your plan to execute? Is your staffing in place? What would your budget look like? Or if the city reduces itself by 10%, if the economy goes the other way, same thing. How would you staff yourself? How would you budget your department? The next one is the city department metrics. Every department needs a way to measure themselves. So the city manager's going to look at how we should measure each department to know if they're performing well or if we've got gaps in performance that need to be addressed. Next item is the city organizational chart and staffing review and optimization of our staffing. Just take a fresh look at the organizational chart. Do we have all the right people? Are they in the right spot? Do we have openings that we need to fill that are critical? Or are there things that don't make sense in the organizational structure that maybe we need to change to execute better? So the city manager will do that review. The next one I think is important, which is an employee survey and awards recognition program. I don't think we do enough to recognize the people in the city that really work hard, work a lot of overtime, they're out in the heat, they're doing all the events, they're those folks. We need to give awards for those that come up with good ideas, because we're after good ideas to try to improve the city. I've heard three or four just in the last couple of weeks that I think were phenomenal ideas. So we want to reward employees for those kinds of things. And then the last one here is a city input porthole or program, a place where citizens of the city can come and talk to us, either via the website or some means, so that we can hear all the good things and hear all the criticism, but we have to answer those in a particular reasonable time period. I put down here 3 business days, so somebody's going to be responsible to respond to those, at least, hey, we're looking into it, or we've got a lot of work here to figure this out. But the other thing which Randy brought up, I think is a great idea, we're going to have neighborhood meetings. People will break the city, I think they said six zones, and we'll have neighborhood meetings. We're actually going to get out in the evening and meet in the neighborhoods and talk to people in the neighborhoods. You know, what's going on here? Do you see issues? Do you like what you see? Do you have sewer, water, power? You know, what? Just let them tell us what's going on, and that way we'll learn what we need to do different going forward. So those are the things that we laid out for the city objectives for this year. So that's on a piece of paper that the city manager got. I've got copies, so if y'all want to see more detail, then we'll talk later about that. All right, and I will say on a positive note, the city's bond rating agencies are up. We talked about that last time. That's the direction that all of this stuff we're talking about needs to take us. So we need to keep moving forward in a way to put the city in a very positive financial position, so that we can then borrow money at low market interest rates. We can do the things we need to do financially to make a healthy city, you know, look back 4 or 5 years from now. And it's not going to be easy, but if everybody works together, we can do it. So we're going to have to pick up the pace a little bit. We're going to have to work a little harder, a little smarter, but we can do it. And that's all I've got. Again, thanks for everybody being here. Any council members got anything to add?
Just, I wish we had this 4 or 5 years ago, Ms. Dunbar. I appreciate your hard work. I know you work with the city manager, calling the CFO, and putting some of this together. We had that kind of leadership years ago. I think Bruce would be on a better path than we are. And I thank you again, sir, for what you put together. And I'd ask that he put together be part of the record.
And I also would like to thank everybody for coming out tonight. I'd like to see more people. We got way too many empty seats. We need to get the community more involved. We need your input. We need guidance. We need solutions. So the city needs to work together as a team. And when we start talking to each other, we'll figure out that we're really not that far apart. We just got to start talking, and we need answers. Well, you know, if you have a situation you feel like needs to be corrected, along with bringing that situation to light, give us some ideas of what you're thinking it'd take to correct it. And so, you know, just dropping it on us, thinking we've got everything figured out, because we're no different than anybody else. We got to get our heads together, and we got to work as a team. And the more heads that's at the table, the better you can figure things out. So I appreciate y'all coming, and I'd like to see more. Thank you.
Yeah, I had no problem with your plan as laid out. Things are very good, hard work. Appreciate it. Looks good.
I agree. It's a good direction to go. A lot of things that you've talked about for a long time.
So I appreciate the support. So let's move on to the first regular agenda item. Consider seeking proposals for financial audit services for the city of Bristol, Virginia.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to move that we combine the first 3 agenda items into a single request for the city attorney to continue his review of the fall's financial and contractual documents, and also a review of the city's financial and contractual documents. If he finds unexplained or suspicious activity or illegal activity, he should go directly to law enforcement with his findings. We should not be informed, the council, of what your investigation is finding, if anything, until such time as it's either permission given by law enforcement or investigation is over. I don't, because of the BDU that I learned, I don't want to be involved knowing anything. I don't know anything now, and I don't want to know anything. Whatever you find, you present it to law enforcement. Don't tell me about it. That's a motion.
I'll second that.
I just ask also that we have this statement Mr. Hubbard gave. It's not with you all. I'd ask that it be put made part of the record in the motion that you made tonight for the official record. And I have a copy if you want. It's also on Outlook that was sent to us.
Any other council comments?
Well, my comments is I understand where you're coming from, Mr. Hubbard, and I appreciate that. But we're not going to know where we're at until there's an audit. And council's not going to make a decision on anything that's whether it's illegal, legal or illegal. The audits are going to tell us what we need to know. And there may be a suit after all the audits are done, and there may not be. But we need to find out, because there is a lot of red flags that's wrapped around this cause.
And there's no point here.
There's nobody in this council that has the knowledge, nor the time, and the experience to go through all of that. And so the only way to really deal with it is with audits. And then when the audits are complete, we'll know more about where we're at. So that's what this is all about. As far as us knowing anything, I don't care to know neither. I mean, we'll lay all the legal entities out there figure all that out. But I do think that we need to move forward with what is presented to us.
One of the minor problem is council didn't put any money in the current budget to pay for this type of
stuff. We don't even know what it's going to cost yet, Mr.
Well, I understand that. And I understand if it's not much, then it's no big deal.
And here's the thing. If the council voted on your motion, it would just be exactly the same thing we've had in the city for a year. Because we talked, when I came on council, Mr. Bumpire came on council, we talked about doing an audit. We talked about this for a year. We requested things. I specifically requested things from the former city manager. Got nothing except a promise to give to him. Now, I'll tell you, whatever the money that we spend on these things may turn out to be money that comes back to us 10, 15 times over. It sure as heck a better chance than what we did in betting on Cabela's, betting on paying more for a road that falls with taxpayer money, borrowing more money. I choose to think that we do the right thing as a council instead of the cowardly thing as a council. And the cowardly thing's been to duck and run. That's how it's been for
Sorry you took it that way. It's not about Doug and Karani. It's asking the attorney to use his knowledge of the law. If he sees anything suspicious, turn it over to law enforcement.
When's he going to do that? When's he going to do that? He's city manager, inner city manager, and he's also the attorney. And he also has a wife. So if you use your philosophy, your strategy, it'll be sometime in the year 2020. And probably any player will be dead by then, perhaps, or in the Bahamas or somewhere. So, you know, let's do what we need to do. Let's pony it up. There's positions that haven't been filled. There's money we can find to do this. We don't even know how much money we're talking about at this point in time. So, you know, I mean, I guess you've got a motion on the floor. Mr. Hartley, second your motion. So.
Well, let me say a couple things. I think both of you are right. But the intent of this, the context of this, I think you need to take it out of context a little bit. When you're an organization like the city, I mean, we all know you can have citizens, right? There's been a lot of negative things happen over several years. But if, let's say, a bunch of positive things have happened over the last several years, you still need to look at yourself in a very serious and unbiased manner, no matter what. So the context of this audit is really to come in and just, you know, take a look at the financial movement of transactions in the city. Are we doing really good at it? Are we world class? Or are there concerns that they need to tell us about that we may need to change our policy? So it's really a more of a high level, you know, look at what has happened to kind of guide us, right, to where we need to go. Now, if in the process of that, and the scope of the RFP, which is a request or proposal, it's not we're spending money, says we do find something in our review. There's something that we found that's quite concerning. Therefore, the city manager, city attorney, and whatever legal perspective he thinks need to be taken, we'll look into that to see if there's anything to that. But that's not the intent of the audit. It's really more to look at what has happened over the last several years, and are there things in the charter and the policies of the city that we really need to change going forward so we don't come back to this place again. He was trying to make us better going forward. That's what the intent is.
Well, I will remind everybody that we have been paying big bucks for audits for the last several years. And maybe we can use that money to do these audits that you guys are talking about.
Well, BB, you pay $50,000 for that clean audit. In fact, you were on the board when everybody got up there and applauded. No, sir, go back and look at the tapes, pal. $50,000 value, whatever. It's the same audit firm, Brown Edwards. It's the same audit for the city of Bristol, Virginia, back when the falls was being developed and so on. They did the exact same thing, just like they did BB. One big happy family.
Not the same
people. Thing. Brown Edwards did the city of Bristol, Virginia.
So I know I said not the last 2 years.
Well, no. Back when the BDU scandal was erupting, they were also doing the city. At the same time, by the way, it came out that the fall was going on. So, you know, hey.
Well, a lot of people think that just because you do a financial audit every year of an organization, that audit's going to uncover.
Criminal
activity, it won't.
Right.
Because
the CPA firm. The kind of audit you're talking about could be done by the current audit.
So an accounting firm, right, you're the client. They're going to come in and do the audit. They're going to do it based on how you wrote the scope. And so if you write the scope.
Well, they do government standards. You've got to go to
the They do the scope to the government accounting standard, right? And you're the client. So they come in and audit it. And if they find something, you know, that's materially significant, whether it's a balance sheet or cash flow, they write it down. But it doesn't mean they're going to dig deeper to see what you really need to know.
I understand. You've got to pay for them. They will do it if you pay.
I'm going to find out how this LLC in Norfolk, Virginia was involved in the Falls transactions. And the only way you're going to do that is forensic audit. Okay? And you know, I'm always kind of curious, you know, different. An LLC out of Norfolk, Virginia was involved?
Really?
Really? Really? With one of
the developers? Involved anywhere.
Let me see a raising the hands of anybody in the city that wants to see what's happened over the last 7-8 years happen again.
You want to continue?
No, I don't want it to happen again.
No, okay. Exactly. Okay, I misunderstood the question. Okay.
So nobody wants to see that happen again. So that means we've got to look really hard at what led us through that time period. And we may find nothing. But we may find 4 or 5 things that we really need to focus on, right? That we need to fix,
that's
that we have gaps in our policies.
To do the investigation.
It may not be law enforcement.
There has to be probable cause. Yeah. The only way we develop probable cause is not for us to do. We have suspicions, but that's not enough to get an investigation. That's why we have a forensic audit. Make sure we understand. We're talking about a comprehensive forensic audit of everyone from starting with the option contracts, who went out and did the options, where were they, did they also take part in real estate, did they get commission? And if they did, there's a conflict of interest because they never appraised the property at cost. So they were basically working for the city and also working for their own back pockets. Now, guess what? That's not right. Now, there's certain elite groups in Bristol that run this city for too long, and then the elites pick dummies to be on council. Okay? The way to stop the elites from controlling anything is to get to the bottom of the falls mess.
Okay, Mr. Trump.
I'd be on some island.
Well, it's just not the falls.
I understand.
All together. We went through this last budget cycle. I had several questions with the last audit that we went through, and nobody could answer them. I was told we'll get back to you. Well, nobody ever got back to
you. Well, auditors are auditors. So the ones you hire are going to give you the same runaround if they get the chance.
If we pay them, we deserve the answers.
Absolutely.
We have to answer a question at least. I'm just tickled to death that our questions from our audits can simply answer the questions. I'm not sure that ever happened before. It hadn't happened until you came here. Well, thank you.
All right, we've got a motion on the floor in a second to combine the first three. Are we ready to move?
I'm ready.
All right. Clerk, call it.
Later.
Same, I guess. No.
Bartley.
No.
You say no or abstain?
I'm not even doing anything.
Abstain?
No.
Yeah.
Hartley?
Yes.
Hubbard?
Yeah.
Lingard?
No.
Not here.
No.
Now we got a tie. Motion to carry. That's fishing.
First agenda item, consider seeking proposal for financial office services, so staff report.
Council, in regards to allowing the city to seek a request for a proposal for a financial audit report, you all have discussed the majority of the issues that I was going to discuss with you in regards to this issue. As it's been echoed up there, this is a big picture. Where are the red flags, and what do we need to do to solve those problems in the future so they don't happen again? And at this time, remember, this is just you all allowing me permission to get a request for proposals. We're not spending any money at the moment. We just want to see how much it's going to cost us. Is it going to be cost prohibitive? Is it reasonable? Is it something we can live with? And depending on what those proposals are when they come back, we'll then make a determination as to whether or not any audit will be conducted in a forensic style manner. So at this point, the only thing that I'm asking for is permission to publish a request for proposal to allow a forensic audit of our finances so that we can highlight those there's areas that are of concern to council and to city management.
And just recently, would it be in the form of a motion to approve a forensic audit and put a specific time frame within it? Like when the falls initially started, when that whole dream was concocted and so forth and so on, would it be appropriate to start there and move forward to the new life issues which are troubling it, so at least?
I think the appropriate time period would probably be begin in 2010 and move forward. That gets us right before the falls. And also in that request for proposal, I would make sure the scope would allow us to go back to 2009 or 2008 if necessary, if they found something in 2010 that they couldn't necessarily get the answer for. So what we're looking at is one 2010 to present day. And then that scope would also allow us to go back if there was something that occurred in 2010 or 11 that maybe does not show up, but might show up in 2008 or 2009. So the scope of this audit would allow us to look at those financial transactions. Now, what you're going to have to understand, even though we have this forensic audit of our accounting systems, our financial auditing company will only be able to trace the funds so far. It can only get to X. And it appears, at least from what I'm seeing, that we want to go beyond X.
Yes.
And so we're going to be limited as to what we can do. That ties in to number 3 on the agenda item. Under section 1503 of the city charter, with council's permission, it gives myself the authority to investigate city affairs, which in turn gives me subpoena power. So if our financial auditing team or our legal auditing team says, hey, we need these documents from X, Y, and Z, can you get those? By virtue of 1503, I can issue the subpoena.
Save us money.
And potentially save us money. And then we can get the answer. It may be, the answer may be, it's a clean transaction. The answer may be, it should have been done this way. But at the end of the day, we can at least get some of those questions answered so that everybody can move forward. And I think this council's in a position to start moving the city forward and not moving backward.
Amen. Let me ask you this, Mr. Reeves. Do you have subpoena powers to your bank statements and bank records?
The way I read the charter, it appears that I can compel the production of books and papers, along with other things. So, I would consider bank statements papers.
Are you anything else on the staff report?
I'll just say this. My comments in regards to item two on the agenda would basically be the same. That way I don't have to necessarily repeat myself.
Right. All right, public comment. I think one person, Mr. Waller, has signed up for item one.
Thank you, gentlemen, of the council. My name is Michael Pollard. I live at 101 Ashley Drive. Previously, it had been mentioned the possibility of seeing if the state would pursue such an audit. I was wondering if anything had been discovered concerning that. That way, not only would we not have to fund the audit ourselves, whether it be a financial audit or a legal audit, but at the same time, local hands will be clear of it. There will be no question that nobody local is involved with the results. And the state can be a lot more demanding than we could possibly be locally. And right now, I think we can find anything we possibly can. We didn't know if anything had been discovered or concerning that.
We actually talked about that. And you want to answer that?
Mr. Pollard, we do intend on contacting the state to see if they'd be willing to take on this audit. There's no guarantee that they would, but in an effort to save city funds, you know, that's going to be my first step. I'm not exactly sure what their scope of their audit could entail at this point or what their limitations would be, but I'm going to have that conversation with the state to determine how we best proceed with them or what we need to do with
them. Ms. Reach has been on the job, you know, a short period of time. We've asked this thing, the former city manager, forward. Now, the issue is, of course, we've talked with this council. The issue is, we can't do anything until January to the legislative session. So I'll tell you the answer right now. You can go ahead and call, but that's the answer. We have to ask our legislators to do that, okay? But if we wait another 5 or 6 months, in other words, we get someone involved and start putting things together, then the state is going to have to do this, because this falls particularly as a development of regional impact. It's supposed to give 2,000 jobs. So the state, since they got us involved in this to a certain extent, with the help of others, local, they would have to just about come in to all of this, because my suspicions are right now, if there's 100 jobs, this falls, it would be a large number. And so I think the answer to your question is, we wait another 5 or 6 months and not come back. I don't prefer to do that.
Okay, so basically it comes down to pursuing all possible options. That's one of them, and one that we would like to see, but nothing can be done until the next legislative session.
That's correct, and I would not expect, based on timing of getting these requests for proposals out, I would like to have them out within the next 2 weeks. I would suspect we'd get at least 30 days, if not 35 days, for people to respond. So we'd be looking, roughly mid-September probably before we even have an actual cost from any auditing firms to be able to give us any idea of where we should go.
Okay. And I think the other thing we talked about was you don't necessarily want to bring the state APA team in unless you know you really got something serious to look at necessarily. So it might be more prevalent for us to let the RFP happen, let the high-level forensics be done, and see if there's identification of things that would warrant bringing the state in, and then there's more substance to him talking to the state of why and what needs to be looked at. So that'll all have to be thought through and be done, I think.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, another public comment. The council motion on number one is to consider giving the city manager the ability to seek proposals or RFPs for financial audit services for the city of West Virginia.
I make a motion to give the city attorney permission to go forward with this financial audit. May I ask that forensic financial audit should be the appropriate language, I think.
Well,
for
looking
at the steps.
Yeah, but item two.
Forensic financial. Forensic audit. There should be a forensic.
That's all inclusive rather than just a financial audit.
We
get that already.
I make a motion for again the
forensic
audit be performed. I second that motion.
All right, council discussion.
Yeah, I'm still, I understand the rationale behind this, but I'm still very unclear as to what the scope of this is. And I just, you know, to me it's hard to vote on something when I don't really even know what I'm doing, what the scope we're asking somebody to come in and do. I know, you know, at this point we're also just asking for proposals, but at some point then we have to fund those proposals, and that gives me a lot of concern that for the past, you know, up until 3 weeks ago, we were trying to cut money and find everywhere to save. If this was something that was the intent to do, then why didn't we bring this up and talk about it during the budget process to put some money aside for this, for all of these first 3 items? Because I think you're looking at...
We will talk about it.
During the budget process.
Yes, sir. The back of the video is... You're the mayor, sir. You know, we've been talking about this for years. I mean, yeah, and surprise,
and you want to say again, the scope has not been written. We're here in the authority to write the scope, which would be part of the RFP. So we want to kind of give some general content that would be in the scope.
Well, as discussed previously, the scope would go back to any financial transactions that occurred from 2010 forward. And I don't want to specifically say to the falls, but that was going to be one aspect of the scope, is reviewing the false transactions, because as it's been echoed up from council, the city has gotten into a situation where we do not want to be again, and we have to figure out what happened in order to prevent us from going down that same path a second time. And quite honestly, there may not be a chance for a second time unless we fix the issues that we've had in the past. So, and I'm not saying that there's, and I don't say that to be negative. What I'm saying is, right now we have an opportunity to change, to turn the tide, so that we can look at those things. Now, in regards to Mr. Hartley's concern about the scope, that scope is going to look at financial transactions that occurred from 2010 forward in order to determine where money came from in order to allow us to fund this project, where that money was spent, and who it went to. And I think I've echoed this to you before. We don't know, we can only go so far in this audit because we can only get to X. We can't get to Y and Z. And by that I mean, we know that the money ended up somewhere, to someone, to the seller of the property or to the seller of a good or whatever the situation was at the time. Not just at the falls, I want to reiterate, but throughout the city. And then we have to determine what happened after that. Were there some things that went on beyond our purview that we weren't privy to that in the back end potentially hurt the city of Bristol? And that's the best that I can define the scope at this point, at least orally. I think once I have the authority to write the proposal, I can present that to council so that if the scope is too broad, I'll take those comments and consideration. We can narrow that scope, or if my scope is too narrow, we can broaden that scope.
So then how does the scope differ from, the city's had audits, the IBA's had audits, all this money should have went through the IBA with no more transactions. I don't see how they would do a sampling because there's very few transactions there. As Councilman Clinger pointed out, he requested a list of transactions for the falls, and we were provided with that, so we know where the money went, the sources are. But I don't understand what this is, given that scope, necessarily what this is adding to, other than unbudgeted costs.
Well, there's conflict of interest. Let me answer that question, too. There's potential conflicts of interest among our people that represent the city and the transactions, land transactions, and so forth, double dealing and so forth. There's potential insurance to be recovered there, Mr. Hartley. And there is some concern. No, we can get everything. I asked to look at settlement statements. Banks, how they settled the accounts for the city. I didn't see any of that. Maybe you did. But, what we've gotten here, what I've gotten in 1 year of the city council, is piecemeal stuff. And it's not my responsibility to come down here and want it. It's my responsibility to go through 10,000 pages of bond stuff up there where the city
basically said, we've got five businesses coming in. That's the kind of things we need to find out. And a fiscal audit will do that. A forensic audit will do it. Maybe you don't want to know, okay? Maybe you don't want to know, but I want to know. I want to know. If anything was improperly done, then you go to jail.
I don't disagree with that. Well, there are some, but I mean, I just don't understand from what you're saying. How is this going to deal any different than what had been already done? That's what I'm trying to understand.
All right, let me give you an example. Let's say that the forensic audit looks at the New Life project and it says, you know what? The city sat down and offered tax relief to this company called New Life. And we find that a significant amount of monies were promised, and there was not a single company D&B report run. There was not a single three-year actual P&L run. There was no cash flow statements. There was no financial justification to verify that company could execute what it was saying it could execute. So therefore, we got a company that pulled out, potentially put the city in a liability situation. And the whole root cause there, the lesson learned is, you better tighten up your policy on how you put together a financial approval by any entity that's asking to do anything in this city so you don't put yourself in that position. So in the private business world, you go out and get a new supplier, right? You run a D&B report, you run financials, you make sure they're legitimate, how long they've been in business, the lawsuit against them, you know, the full breadth of that. So that you don't wake up and you see Dave McGee writing an article in the paper about New Life. I mean, I might get up Saturday morning and walking down the driveway, but I'm tired of opening the paper up and seeing those articles. And the way you get out of that, right, is you just do a good forensic audit and you say, what did we do wrong? And what do we got to do to tighten up our performance here so we don't ever let that happen again? Because a lot of us won't be around years from now, right? But if you put good policies in place, then it establishes the execution of the city, so you continue to do business that way, so you don't have another New Life, that may be a bad example, but another company like them show up and promise things, and then it doesn't turn out well.
And Bill, and Mr. Harvey, another thing, you know, realistically, BBU always pride themselves on audit. They never ask to how good an audit. They never even asked if they had a credit card. Turned out they had like 70. I mean, I don't know how many credit cards. Everybody had a credit card. You work there, you got a credit card.
And again, what I'm trying to, without seeing the scope of work, I'm just trying to figure out how this is different. And again, some of this, and when we get to the other one, I'm not really sure what you mean by the term legal audit.
Exactly.
So I'd like to see the scope of work for that. But I mean, I mean, my point is, I'm not opposed to necessarily saying that this needs to be looked at. I'm just not sure what I'm voting for.
Well, and here's what I'm
voting for. And how we're going to fund it. But I realize that's a separate issue. Yes. Those are my two major concerns. And I think, particularly from the funding side, we could have brought that up a few weeks ago.
I thought we did, but if we didn't, you know, I mean, we talked about so much, had so many hours of meetings. Part of what I'm trying to do. What I'd like to see happen is to connect the dots. Okay, that's the way I'm looking at this. And, you know, just a straight up financial audit doesn't connect to anything. They come in, they say, you know, Ms. CFO, give me X. And you give them X. But, you know, they call you advance so they'll have X ready. But they don't really go through anything. This is going to be allow us, God willing, it's not too expensive. We'll cross that bridge when we get to it, okay? But
I promise you.
Well,
I would expect it to be expensive because this is going to be a debt that was audit that follows the money everywhere for the past
a lot of transactions.
Let's not worry about that. Let's wait till we see the bill
before
we worry
about it. You've got to see the bill, and you've heard the term.
That will change our tune, not
maybe.
And you've heard the term penny wise and dollar foolish, right?
Yeah.
So, if you would have done this 10 years ago, how many millions of dollars would the city have saved?
Absolutely.
You've got to think of it in those terms. So if you do this, we're looking to what we're going to save the city going forward. We don't want to get them into a financial position where they take the money that's taxpayer money and basically let it go to the wind, right? We're trying to prevent millions of dollars of waste from occurring.
We need an in-depth audit to tell us where we went wrong.
Where we went wrong.
In this whole entire city. Not just the boss, but this whole entire city. We need to know where we went wrong. I mean, I'm sorry, guys, but I don't drive by Lee Highway and look up there and see $58 million. I don't see it.
Are you counting the bells?
$52 million, and then just last fall, y'all voted for three more million roads. I'm sorry, so take $3 million away from that. We're at $55 million.
Well, actually, $23 million
went to other areas.
$23 million for the lane. We borrowed 80, but then nobody realized, the taxpayers of the city of West Virginia didn't realize that our great financial advisors, which some people put so much great store in, were getting points on top of that. So why we had to borrow the $3 million is because the bond people, our good financial people, took $4 million off the top.
They love every time we do that.
Yeah, they love coming down here to Bristol. This is Sac City.
Yes, it is.
And to ever say that their financial advisors is realistically, it's aberrant to me how you can call that group. They are financial people that take care of themselves and have done well all over the Commonwealth of Virginia. Yes, city, yes, town, yes, county, borrow. That's a great project. I'll help you get the funding. And then they take their points. So every time they come down here, I will tell you, I'm going to excuse myself, because I can't stand to be in the same room as other people. They've done more harm to this city and taken more off this city than the landowners. That was $23 million for the land, $18 million to take the land down and develop it. That's my last. And then Cabela's got $17.5 million to show up here and they build them a building. So you put those together, plus the $3 million, plus all the additional expenses of taking some stupid tower on this property over here. Okay? Now that's the logic of Bristol. So if you don't want to have consequences, elections have consequences. And 2010, we are reaping the rewards and benefits of that election right now, every day. Every day.
Okay, any more discussion? We got a motion on the table, a second. Any more discussion? All right. Press call roll.
Leader?
Yes.
Hartley?
Abstain.
Lever?
Abstain.
Lingard?
Yes.
Mumpower?
Yes. All right, item 2 on the agenda, consider seeking proposals for legal and legal services for the City of West Virginia staff report.
Council, my previous comments I would incorporate into this issue here. This legal audit, Mr. Fleener has mentioned, it would give us ideas and potential conflicts of interest that may or may not occur. And once again, the scope of this would be to allow us to see any red flags. It doesn't necessarily mean that they have to delve into the entire thing to the very end, but it would at least give us a list of red flags that concerns them that Ben and I could have take the time to investigate further and report to council if necessary, report to other authorities if necessary.
Mr. East, can I ask you a question, sir?
Sure.
Would you recommend that we have a law firm outside of this area? Can we do that? I mean, I probably should have asked about the forensic financial audit, but with the legal position, would you recommend that at all to get it?
I would recommend that any audit is conducted, that the firms potentially not only be from outside this area, but potentially from outside the Commonwealth of Virginia.
How would we do that as far as legal is concerned?
What's the question outside this Commonwealth?
Yes, sir.
That's something I'll have to look into. We may not be able to get a firm from outside the Commonwealth, but
Can you put out instead of an RFP and RFQ?
Do what?
A request for qualifications for this qualifying?
Yeah, I could do that.
And that be one of the qualifications?
Or you could write that in this code or RFP that they got to get their qualifications.
Yeah, I know what you're saying, so, but I don't know if that's the scope of work, but if you're qualifying somebody.
No, you can just say, oh, the RFP, the firm has to provide their proof that they can, that they know Virginia law, they're certified to do the upgrades in state of Virginia, and they've done these types of audits for 10 years or whatever, they find their firm.
Can you combine the two?
Well, I don't know. You know, that's a question. Procurement-wise, I mean, I know certain services you can put out. Request ask for qualifications and then go through competitive bidding or something. I don't know if it's possible.
You know, to answer that question, you do both at the same time.
I've read those statutes. I'll have to double check. I would think we'd be able to combine those, but I'd be afraid to answer that right now without double checking those statutes.
And part of the motion, if it, you know, made and passed, I think it needs to be out of the area. Support at a minimum. I agree with you, preferably out of the Commonwealth. And I also probably would suggest that whoever is hired in the RFP or request for qualifications in terms of district is, should be also stated that they have to work hand in hand with any information that they come across that comes into any kind of legality potentially. They work hand in hand with our law enforcement authorities and so forth. So I think we're ethically bound as attorneys to do that, but I'm just asking you if you agree with that.
I mean, I think ethically, you know, if we run across criminal conduct as city attorney, I have to turn that over to law enforcement, not necessarily the auditing firm, because they will be reporting those findings back to me, and then it's on my shoulders to make the appropriate call.
I think it's clear this particular legal audit is designed or will be designed to look at conflict of interest issues.
That's how I understand from the discussion
that
is.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Councilman.
Plus all the contracts, legal contracts that are in play that occurred through that time period to see if there's any.
Well, I think your contracts
that aren't executed or aren't available or missing. Parts of the contract that puts the city liability. I mean, there could be lots of things come out of legal review. So you got to look at the contracts and the documents that lead up to the thing you're looking at.
Well, you also need to do that to determine if there was a conflict.
Well, inherently, a contract is going to name all your parties. And you will be able to look at contracts to determine whether or not one entity contracted with another entity, but who was each entity representing. The contractual obligations would be looked at just based upon the fact that looking for conflicts of interest, I believe.
Would this be a quasi-criminal and civil firm? Because, I mean, realistically, we're talking about all this potentially crossover into civil and potential.
I think the scope of the work, it's going to, what I anticipate their answers being, well, one, I anticipate their answers being, you know, everything was done appropriately at the falls, and, you know, it may not have been smart decisions, but it was done appropriately. That's my hope for the city.
It's a good thing that ignorance isn't illegal, because I've been in jail since I was 18.
Well, we've been selling this. But I was making dumb decisions then.
Although Bristol City might. They might try it.
I forgot where this question or my answer was going.
It started at 8 years old.
And that goes to Mr. Roberts, assuming I had any knowledge of the law. He made a comment a minute ago that I had knowledge of the law. So I think where I was going, the auditing firm would look at the civil criminal aspect of it. I think based on the audit's findings, we would know whether it's civil or criminal just based on what the findings are.
So, where you said the finding of I guess my question is, how much of this, I know when you came on as attorney, one of the just, again, I can see this being very, considering very costly, but I guess how far did you get to that, and how much do you think is still there to be looked at?
All right. Let me kind of, I'll kind of give you a timeline of events. It's approximately the second week of March. At that point, I had an opportunity. I think I had a request to review the contracts, the option contracts, to purchase the falls. I reviewed all those contracts. I want to say it was maybe 15 or 16. I can't remember. And I reviewed the entities involved with those contracts, and I sent a fairly lengthy email in regards to my findings with those contracts. The second week of June, I reviewed the bond paperwork that Mr. Kleiner refers to. What that bond paperwork showed, that was the conclusion of the entire fall situation. What I do not have is what paperwork the bond company relied on in order to get the bonds issued. Now, I'm in the process of attempting to collect those documents. And that's as far as I'll go right there. So it's at this point, it's difficult for me to say what else it is to review. Those bond documents, on their face, they're in proper order. I mean, because I have no idea of what the history that led to the issuance of those bonds are. I mean, I know the history in broad terms, but I don't know, you know, the specifics that led to those documents. So it's hard for me to say what the bond company based their decision on, because at the moment, those documents are still being gathered for me to look at.
And I guess another question is, as you go through reviewing this, you know, some of this stuff, for example, bonds and stuff, has already been litigated. And so, I mean, you know, what, I guess, other outstanding.
Well,
and I guess part of this is, again, trying to understand what's the scope and all that. I mean, if it's, you know, what all you're going to look at and how much, because again, that's where it's hard to.
Well, we don't duplicate what's already been determined by law or whatever. We should be trying to prove it.
If you look at the previous lawsuits, those lawsuits necessarily don't have any bearing on, I believe, what counsel is wanting to be looked at. Part of explaining some of these issues in closed session.
Yes.
But I'm trying to give you enough information right now so that you can make an appropriate decision. But those lawsuits that were litigated, at least on my review of those lawsuits, are not going to get the answers that counsel desires to see. Now, once again, at the end of the day, I hope that the answers are, you know, things were done appropriately. You might tighten up this control a little bit more, do this a little bit different. At the end of the day, I don't think this council nor the citizens want to see that anything was done so inappropriate that the U.S. Attorney's Office.
Well, I'll
tell you an example of what I've seen happen multiple times. Let's say a contract is signed by an executive of a firm, and they did not have the authorization to sign and execute that contract. And there was no document that said they would be executioner for that company, and that makes that contract null and void. So there's lots of legal issues that you'll come across when you start to look at contracts. And until you get into it, you don't know, you know, what you're facing, but I'm sure they'll find problems. It just depends on the extent and the level of the problems. Whether it's, you know, there's really nothing there except somebody signed a contract that shouldn't, you have to send it back for resignature, or there's something they potentially fraud or conflict of interest or other things at play, which that would lead down another path.
Mr. East knows where I'm going with this, and I think it would be more appropriate that we go and talk about this in public. sensitive things from part of here, to be perfectly candid with you, that, that I don't think need to be.
I mean, I'm just like to say.
We need to move on the city. Yeah. We got to look at this. We just need to have the trust in our city attorney and our city manager to look at this properly and say everything was fine, or we got some things we need to talk about.
I agree. So before we read for motion.
No comments. I see there's no one signed up for public comment number two. So, no one ready for council motion.
My question, Mr. City Manager, would be a forensic legal audit and so forth. Would that be how it would be phrased? I don't know. We're just simply say legal assistance to acquire legal assistance, preferably outside of our local area, with an RFP, RFP.
Well, I think the appropriate language would be that you would make a motion to authorize the city manager to publish a request for proposal with certain qualifications for a legal audit of contractual issues within the city of Bristol.
From 2010 forward.
If that's what you desire.
Can I just say what you said? And that be my motion? I have to say that again. I don't know if you're doing it again. Okay, I'm trying. I move that the city allow our city manager to put out an RFP along with request for qualifications, specifically their license practices in Commonwealth, Virginia, but preferably they'll be outside the area to avoid any appearance of prejudice or whatever. And that the period be covered from 2010 commencement of the falls matters, starting the option contract discussions, and concluding with, I would assume,
2016.
Okay. Sorry. June 30, 2016. Okay. And nobody can repeat that either.
Thank you, Mr. Vidya.
What about you, sir?
Do I have a second?
I second that.
All right. Cancel discussion. Clerk, call the roll.
Lehman?
Yes.
Hartley?
Abstain.
Hubbard?
Yes.
Wingard?
Yes.
Mumgarth?
Yes. All right, item three, consider investigation of city affairs. Staff report, you want to kind of put this in context with what we just
I mentioned this previously. Under section 1503 of the charter, council has the authority to grant me as city attorney and the authority to subpoena witnesses and administer oaths and compel the production of books and papers in regards to an investigation into city affairs. By virtue of these audits, there may be documents that we don't necessarily have control of, and if the auditing firm says we need X, Y, Z document, can you get that? Then I have the ability to issue a subpoena to compel production of those documents.
So you basically fall into what we're doing with, anyway?
Correct.
You would be able to give the legal audit individuals the opportunity to have subpoena power that they may not otherwise have if there's no litigation?
That's correct.
Okay, so basically this particular thing will be just to get information needed by the auditors that are doing our first two audits.
That's correct.
All right.
So what is that for staff report?
That's it.
All right, we got public comment.
If that's already in the code.
It's in the charter of section 1503.
So does it have to be voted on? If it's already in the charter, you just implement charter.
By virtue of my new position, it probably doesn't necessarily need to be voted on, but at the time when I think we were considering this, I was not city manager. I'll read this to you.
Okay.
It says the council, the city manager, and any officer, board, or commission authorized by them or either of them shall have the power to make investigation as to city affairs. For that purpose, the council, city manager, or any such officer, board, or commission shall have the power to subpoena witnesses, administer oaths, and compel the production of books and papers. And then it goes on to discuss what happens if someone refuses to do that.
Okay. So it's probably better if you go ahead and do this tonight. And since we're doing that, we can do it in 30 days and get our RFP if we wait till then. Is that correct?
Yeah, until you put it out, until you actually
have something
for him to, I mean, he's not going to do anything until
I think it's appropriate that until I'm asked to do something by an auditing firm, that there's no reason for me to issue any subpoenas or anything of that nature. But if we want to start this process, let's go ahead and start this process. That way the auditing firm knows they have the capability to get those documents if necessary.
Would you put that in your request and so forth also, that they would be assisting them and so forth?
Table for the time being.
I don't necessarily know if I'd put that in the request or proposal, but they would be aware of it.
So you recommend this be tabled until the first two RFPs are out, or you?
Do we have something to investigate?
Well, and that's going to be the issue. We don't know what the cost of these audits are going to be. So if we're going to do all this in conjunction, it would probably be best to table this issue, bring it back at the time when council authorizes funds to be expended for those audits.
All right, so the recommendation is to table item 3. Will we proceed further about the RFPs?
Well, I have a question.
Well, the public comment.
Gotta wait for the motion first.
All right, so, the motion's not back. So we've got one person signed up?
I think it fell under the other one sufficiently.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, Council, notice for a second.
Move to table.
I'll second that.
So we got a motion to table and a second. Council discussion.
Okay, my comments are going to be, this is on the agenda tonight, and we've already laid foundation and groundwork to move forward with everything pertaining to the city audits and all of this. I would rather go ahead and vote on this tonight, give you the authority to move forward in the future should you feel the need to. If you don't feel the need to, you do nothing with it. So to bring this back before council and us dealing with it again, I do not want to table this. I would like to go ahead and vote on it. If council feels you need approval, to grant you the approval to keep this moving forward, because it's on our agenda, and in my opinion, we need to give the approval or the rejection of it tonight, not table it and bring it back. If you don't need it, you don't need to work with it, you don't use it, then our vote is null and void anyway. But should you need it in the future, you do not have to come back to council over this item. That's my stand on that.
But don't you have the power anyway?
By virtue of our position I've been named now, I do believe I have that power now.
When you put the RFP, you can make that, during the discussion, more explicit.
Here's what I want council to understand, too. In regards to obtaining information from the city, since day one, I've never had any issue with any employee here wanting to cooperate on anything that I've asked them for. They've been over backwards to give me documents in a timely fashion. And honestly, I dare say that they'll continue to do that. I don't have any doubt that they will not continue to do whatever is asked of them. So I understand Mr. Wingard's concerns. If it can go either way. I mean, it can be tabled, it can be brought back at a later date, or it can move on tonight. At the end of the day, I think if I was ever faced with a situation that would require me to do something authorizing 1503, by virtue of the title of city manager, I have that authority as it stands. However, if council wanted to be on the safe side, that way there would be no question asked at some point, because I've already thought of several legal issues that attorneys representing entities might start to use. It would be cleaner at some point if city council specifically authorized me to do that. It doesn't necessarily have to be tonight, but at some point, I'm going to issue a subpoena. I will probably come back to council just to give specific authorization for that.
Well, I personally will tell you, I don't like leaving things lingering like we typically do in government. I think we just reaffirm that he does have the authority based on the charter to RFPs that the firms that are quoting know that he has the ability to go get documents. I think that's important. That way they know their audit will be efficient. So I think my recommendation is we change the motion to just reaffirm that he has that authority and use his discretion to do it as needed.
Can I withdraw my second? On the page?
I agree with the change.
Okay, good.
So is that a second? No, I changed my motion to go ahead and give the authority just to make verbal.
Motion to reaffirm the authority to go for the charter, and Mr. Wingo has seconded. Any discussion?
So this is just to get documents?
Correct.
Well, it would authorize me to do anything pursuant to section 1503 of the city charter.
Who would have the power to quash?
Well, that whatever entity I would subpoena could potentially file a motion to quash. And that's something we probably need to discuss in closed session.
Very sure.
I just don't want to get into a witch hunt type situation. If you're going to go by the, here's what we found in the audit, we need to get this information, I've got you.
It's not my intent to go on a witch hunt,
right,
by any stretch of the imagination.
I think the audit would direct
the audit is what you read me and where I need to go.
That's the professional way that the audit leads you the direction.
If the audit says there's nowhere to go, there's nowhere to go. We wash our hands of it, we move forward, and we put our best foot forward to make everything a Bristol success.
And tell people in fact that there isn't anything.
Yeah.
And the bottom line, this is the only thing that's going to put this discussion to bed, is to have the outside look done and the answer. Are you in the discussion? Okay.
Leader?
Yes.
Bartley?
Yes.
Hubbard?
Yes.
Wingard?
Yes.
Mumgarth?
Yes. All right, item four, consider designation of council member to coordinate with the city manager on staffing.
This was brought on the agenda tonight based upon a resolution that was approved on June 27th. That resolution basically authorizes an open line of communication between the city manager and council in regards to staffing issues. As I explained on June 27th, that resolution does not bind the city manager in management of the city in regards to staffing issues. It's very clear and explicit in the charter that employment issues are solely up to the city manager. However, based on the situation that the city finds itself in, that everyone wants to see the city run more efficiently and effectively, I think it's important that council is involved and knows what's going on and the reasons behind decisions that are being made, and potentially come up with solutions that are not followed by management in order to reach the ultimate goal that we want to reach. So I'm requesting the council appoint a council member that I would have contact with in regards to staffing issues so that council can stay informed by virtue of one council member instead of myself trying to keep five
counts. All right. No one signed up for public comment, so any council want to make a motion?
Mr. Mayor, I would respectfully make a motion that Mr. Wingard, Vice Mayor Wingard, be appointed representative from the city council.
Second.
I have a motion for Mr. Wingard to be the representative on the organizational meetings, and a second by Mr. Hubbard. Please call the
roll. Leader?
Yes.
Bartley?
Yes.
Hubbard?
Yes.
Wingard?
I'm stuck.
You know better than both that guy, right?
Yeah.
Yes. All right, item five, consider furnished requisition, staff report.
Mayor and members of the council. A department requisition form for payment to Appalachian Juvenile Commission for juvenile services for July through September 2017 is presented to City Council to approve the payment of this item. This disbursement is budgeted. The this disbursement is 25% of the line item budget, because this is a quarterly bill. And I would ask the council approve the disbursement in the amount of $48,798.
Anyone sign up for public comment? Any other staff?
Council, I'd also remind you that this is a state mandate. We do not have a choice in funding this Appalachian Juvenile Commission, so this is not something that is discretionary through the budget. It's state mandated, and it's not honestly an obligation we have to pay.
It is an obligation we have to pay, right?
It is.
Yep. But, you know, realistically, instead of bringing these up, if state mandated, realistically, we don't need to. I don't know
how
the rest of
the council feels. Well, that's what I want to say. Our intent is to have mandated items not be brought to council. It's the discretionary funds that, you know, are budgeted but are above the limit that the mandatory items you have to pay. And as long as the proper signature is there and it's within the budget, then the authority has to go and pay it and move on.
Would you like us to change the internal policy that council approved at the last meeting to include the exclusion of mandated disbursements?
That'd be appropriate, I think.
I'd like to see that also approval change to review. I'm not going to approve anything that I didn't personally generate. I learned my lesson a little bit, but I learned from my last board of terms I had.
I don't mind that. I mean,
there's merit to that, and I'm right there with you.
I kind of visit you.
You know? Yeah, I appreciate that.
I hate to tell you, we'll keep you separated. You won't go to the same facility.
Won't go to the same one.
I think that's a good point. And again, while I was opposed to the resolution last time, I think we probably had no opposition to review. I don't see anything wrong with that. It's already been budgeted. I don't know why we're going back through this exercise again.
I agree with you.
So
what we want to do with the motion then is to include wording changes to exclude mandatory
and
expenses
review.
And add change approved to review.
You can say that.
Can we do this?
You can say that 10 times fast.
Okay.
Can we do that in this, or it has to come back as a separate resolution?
I honestly think this will need to be a separate issue.
Good.
On the agenda for the next meeting. And
yeah, make
it clear. The council knowing from this point forward, when we will not present any requisition items that don't meet the requirements that have been enunciated here tonight. Just based on the wording of item number 5, I think that would be outside the purview of what was intended.
So the motion would just be to approve this one?
That's correct.
Any other resources? And so we'll have a motion.
We don't get many years on just one approval.
Move to approve. I got a motion by Mr. Flanger. I second.
Second.
And a second, Mr. Harder. Harder, call the roll.
Flanger.
Yes.
Hartley.
Yes.
Pepper.
Yes.
Wingard.
Yes.
Lumpower.
Yes. All right, on to the consent agenda. I guess we do have someone signed up for a consent non-agenda item. So the first one is consider street closure request for the day of the park event, August 5th, 2017. Do you want to go down through each one of these? Just as that comes to the preview, or we want to approve all these?
I move that we approve the consent agenda as printed.
Second.
All right, so we got a motion to approve the consent agenda as printed. We have a second, Mr. Wingard.
Third. Before we vote, I'd like to make one comment here. We encourage people to go out for the day of the park event, what Mr. Anderson does. If you haven't ever been, it's a really good event. It's where they collect, I have things for kids coming back to school. They can have backs, haircuts, things like that. It's really a very nice community to be in.
It is. And there's one for God. It's
all right, so we have a motion in a second. Got a clerk call roll.
Flanger.
Yes.
Hartley.
Yes.
Pepper.
Yes.
Wingard.
Yes.
Lumpower.
Yes. All right, we, I have made it to present about members of the public, not a gym line, if one person signed up. Is there a letter?
My name is Earl Leonard, and I'm empty chairperson for the empty chair that's in the Tournament Square Park. We've also got 16 of these around the Tri-Cities area, three in Bristol. And we've noticed over the last year or so, the chair has become very deplorable. It was pretty bad, and we brought that to the city manager's office Thursday, and I want to thank him very much. If he got it done, whoever got it done, but it's painted, it's fresh, it looks beautiful now. And I just want to say thank you and job well done on your first few days in your positions.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Nice comment.
Mr. Leonard, I'd like to take credit for that, but I'm not sure who jumped, who took the bull by the horns, but whoever did it. That was probably Ms. Denny here did that.
We talked to Ms. Denny, and I also talked to Mr. Wingard at the parade. He was at the parade, and I mentioned it to him. That it was
so any praise for that should probably go to her and the staff that completed that and time yeah. back.
And Mr. Leonard.
And also, that's the kind of stuff we want to recognize employees for. So if you can know the employer or employees that were involved in that, that'd be perfectly fine to recognize.
I mean, this is a great monument to all the veterans that have never came home. There's 92,000 at the time we put that in, and we're now down to approximately 80,000. So we're bringing them home every day, and that's the purpose. And we'd like to see that Veterans Park stay beautiful and remind everybody that that's the sacrifices that were given to us so we could be here today to do what we do.
Thank you, sir, for what you do.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right,
I can
see city manager's comments.
Council, this is a new item, and the public, too, this is a new item that's been added to the agenda, and I intend on having this item on every agenda from this point forward. And I do this, I want to keep the public updated on what's going on within the city to a degree, but I specifically want to use this time to recognize things that have gone on in the city that are positive. The first thing that I would like to discuss today is the city zoning that was brought up. It's one of our 10 items that we need to discuss, or that's our objectives for the year. Council, I have received a zoning report. I don't know if that's been forwarded to you yet or not. I received it one day, I think maybe Thursday or Friday. Honestly, I haven't had time to read it myself. But it gives us a nice audit of what's going on with our zoning issues and what we need to do to fix certain zoning requirements. So that's a step in the right direction. It's working on one of the objectives that the mayor has implemented for 2017-18. The second thing I'd like to discuss, we've talked about recognizing employees. I have sent out a survey to employees so that they can critique what they think needs to be done within the city and how to make things run more efficiently. And it gives them an opportunity to have a voice. Over my past 7 days in this role, I feel like that employees want to have a say in what's going on. And I think they're going to be a good voice for us, and they will come up with terrific ideas for us to listen to in the future. Third, in regards, this is item 10 on the mayor's objective, are the neighborhood meetings. I believe it was on my first full day on the job, I asked Kelly Miller in our GIS department to divide the city into six zones. He has done that. He has suggested one place in each of those places for us to meet with citizens in those zones. I've got to confirm with those entities if we will be welcome there after hours so that we can meet with members of the public. I intend on having our first meeting on July 24th. I'm not sure exactly which zone that will be in, but there will be a press release. We'll put that on the city's Facebook page, and I'll probably announce that. We don't have a meeting between now and then. So I will get that out to the public so that you will know where that meeting will take place. I want to encourage all citizens to come out, specifically the people that live in that zone. Everyone will know what zone they live in. And we want to hear your concerns. We want to be receptive to your concerns. We want to offer solutions. If we don't have solutions, we want to try to find a solution so that everybody knows we're trying to work on the same goals and to make Bristol a better place. So that's one of my top priorities. Fourth, I want to discuss what's happened over the past week. I don't think the employees of Bristol understand the type of job that they do. I have never been more impressed with the group of individuals that I've seen this past week based upon the transition that has taken place. Everyone that I've dealt with or had to deal with has been extremely positive. They want to do what's best for Bristol. They do their jobs and they do it well. It's amazing when you actually get down with them, go to their offices and see what they do and how they do it. It amazes me how they do what they do. They truly are good employees here in the city. And it's time that they be recognized for what they do. And I think everyone here realizes that. I hope any employees out here realize that you are valued. We do like what you do. And we want to make sure that you understand that. We're here for you. We want to make, everybody wants to make a positive change here. And as I've said before, over the next 90 to 120 days, everything from this point forward needs to be positive with the city. And I intend on doing that with employees first. I intend on making council meetings as positive as I can. And I think as we move forward, we will see the differences that everybody wants to see in the city. And we can move forward with especially the employees' help. I know we had a cookout this past Friday at Clear Creek. I can't thank Casey Sears enough. He pulled that together basically on 2 days' notice, and we had roughly 120-some employees show up. I hope they appreciated it. I enjoyed meeting them, and I look forward to working with each other.
That's a good start. Good start to the first couple of weeks, huh?
First 7 days. We're in week two.
I just want to make one comment for the record. I found out you weren't doing anything from 11 p.m. to midnight. I sent you an email objecting to that slacking off.
I'll make sure from 11 p.m. to midnight I'll be doing something from now on.
Well, he may be doing something that's really positive for him. I've got to, I mean, let's be real.
The last thing, I think the last thing I'll say, he forgot to mention it, but he brought the idea of us meeting on Friday, not here, meeting in the departments. So we will be going and meeting like in the fire department, in the police department. I mean, we want to be out there, get to know people, see what's going on. So every Friday, 3 o'clock, we're going to meet, and the vice president will be with us, but it's not going to be upstairs. It's going to be in the departments. And so we'll rotate around. That way we'll get to see what's going on. And then the last thing is we set up, we saw a pretty cool website review on Friday. We had a new website that was shown to us, and we talked about getting an application maybe looked at, that where people drive down the interstate, their phone goes, Bristol, Virginia, not just necessarily a good place to live, but a good place to stop right now and eat and shop. You know, so that's the kind of stuff we want to do, folks. I mean, we've got to get positive spin on the city. I think that was a good start to the website. I think it's professional looking. It had all the stuff. It's user-friendly. You know, a few details, but I think everybody's going to be really happy with the website and when we get this app spun up. It's going to be a different day. It's going to be really nice.
Mr. Mayor, who's responsible for that? Who did that?
That's Rick Belcher in our IT department.
You're the man. You're the man, Rick. Good job. Really. Fantastic.
The one specific department I would like to mention is dispatch. I spent some time with them last Thursday evening. If you have not been in the dispatch room, I would encourage you to go over there and spend some time. Those people are true professionals under high stress situations, and it is amazing what they do and how quickly they do it. With the ease that they do it, it is beyond amazing. first people you talk to in an emergency, and it's just truly amazing how they conduct themselves.
Well, if you keep this energy level up, if you're able to do that, you know, more power to you, but I'm telling you what, I don't know how you do it, but the firemen, I don't think they want you to sleep overnight with them. They heard you snore, and they're there at nighttime, they want to rest, and so forth, and so on, but, you know, beyond that, I know that you're going to try to do your department, and I appreciate what you've done.
Thank you.
And the last thing I'll say, I guess we'll put this on the website, but there are four openings to different planning commissions, or different committees and commissions. We've got the New River Mount Rogers Workforce, we need one person. We've got the Planning Commission has an opening. Public Library Foundation has an opening, and then the Redevelopment and Housing Authority. So we'll get this on the website, so get the word out. We've got some openings that we need folks to fill for the communities. Okay, that's it. July 11th, City Council, Bristol, Virginia, that is adjourned.